आज से कई साल पहले जब मुगल भारत पे राज कर रहे थे, महाराष्ट्र के एक छोटे से कोने में जन्म हो रहा था स्वराज्य का। छत्रपति शिवाजी महाराज किले पर किले कब्जे में करते जा रहे थे अपने, और एक सपना देख रहे थे, पूरे भारत को एक साथ लाने का सपना। और जो हम पे रूल कर रहे थे उन्हें भारत से बाहर निकालने का सपना। इसी सपने को उनके साथ जी रहे थे उनके बेटे संभाजी महाराज, जो आगे जाके छत्रपति भी बनते हैं। ये कहानी है, ये आज का पॉडकास्ट है छत्रपति संभाजी महाराज पे। इस पॉडकास्ट में हम बात कर रहे हैं मेधा देशमुख भास्करन से, जिन्होंने अपने ज़िंदगी के 20 साल दिए हैं मराठा हिस्ट्री को समझने में। उनका कहना ये है कि जब हम भारतीय इतिहास को देखते हैं तो कहीं ना कहीं हम मराठा हिस्ट्री को भूल जाते हैं, हम उसे इतना इम्पोर्टेंस नहीं देते, और जब हम इम्पोर्टेंस देते हैं तो हम छत्रपति संभाजी महाराज को बहुत ही एक विलेनेस लाइट में दिखाते हैं। उनके बारे में बहुत ही गलत बातें लिखी गई है हमारे इतिहास में। आज हम उन्हीं सब बातों को डिबंक करने वाले हैं। आज हम असली सच्चाई जानने वाले हैं एक बहुत ही गजब के इंसान की, एक बहुत ही अच्छे रूलर की, छत्रपति संभाजी महाराज की। उन्होंने जीते जी तो भारत के लिए बहुत कुछ किया, पर अपने मौत के समय वो भारत को एक बहुत ही बड़ा गिफ्ट दे गए। अगर आपको जानना है ये गिफ्ट क्या था तो इस एपिसोड को एंड तक देखना। हेलो मेधा मैम, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर कमिंग ऑन द शो। आई एम सो हैप्पी टुडे बिकॉज वी आर डिस्कसिंग मराठा हिस्ट्री, स्पेशली द लाइफ एंड डेथ ऑफ छत्रपति संभाजी महाराज। सो लाइक आई हैपन टू you know start reading up on Maratha Empire because of Ranjit Desai, who is a well-known author in the Marathi fiction literature. But then your book, I personally believe it has surpassed all the previous Marathi fiction books on the history of Maratha Empire, and the reason is, like, when I took up the book, it took me like 3 or 4 days to complete the whole book, and I have had dreams where I am in that whole empire, right? It was that engaging. Like, the book is so beautiful. And I have gifted it to a lot of my friends by now. Like, and they are reading the book. They have been telling me, thank you for gifting this book, because it, in a way, it satiates the hunger for history and the hunger for fiction as well. So thank you. Thank you, first of all, for writing this book, ma'am.
This book is actually the entire Maratha history. I started with Chhatrapati Shivaji, his biography. Have you seen this book?
Yeah, I have. In fact, I have ordered the book. Like, I ordered it just before this episode.
Okay. And yeah, then I wanted to write fiction. Have you seen this book?
Yeah.
So then it was a natural, I wanted to take the history further, you see.
Yeah.
You asked me why I thought of Sambhaji. So I wanted to take history further, and I had many discussions with Vaishali Mathur, who is my editor, who I am her author in Penguin, you see.
Correct.
So then we discussed, and actually Frontiers starts from somewhere 1658-57 and ends up to around 1666, Chhatrapati Shivaji's escape from Agra. And then Sambhaji starts from the coronation of Chhatrapati Shivaji, right. That is 1674 till 1689. I don't want to tell the end right now, end.
Yeah.
So in between a few years, I have not written about that history. But Vaishali Mathur and I had long chat because I had met their Vijesh, the one in Penguin who looks after Indian authors. So he asked me to write, on historical fiction for them. So Vaishali and I were wondering which period we should take. And we thought of Sambhaji. That would be very exciting. Not much has been written about him. And that's why Sambhaji was, the idea came 3 years ago to us.
Yeah.
That is how Sambhaji, the book was born at that time.
Correct. So, you know, why I love this book, there are like two major reasons.
And I don't know if these will be the reasons for everyone else or not, but for me personally, first reason was this was the first historical fiction which had a bibliography, which, you know, shows like how much of research has gone into the book. So that was one thing which I really loved. And the second thing is, and this is one thing which I have always felt about Indian historians, especially when we talk about history, we in a way, you know, look at history in a very black and white way. History can never be black and white. It has to be in various shades of gray. And you have shown that in your book. And in fact, you have shown the whole psychology behind what Sambhaji was thinking at that moment. So that is why I love this book.
Yes. Actually, you know, when you say historical fiction, okay, historical fiction is an incorrect word, I feel. It should be historical novel, which has to be based on true history. What happens, you know, if you do not study history well and do not write fiction, then that fictitious history becomes the real history for people who read, which I did not want that to happen. Okay. So the thing is, I discussed this also with Penguin, but the thing is, Amazon does not have any category like historical novel, you see.
Oh, wow.
It's only, so you have to categorize it at historical fiction for the platforms where we sell the book. But unless I study history and I do not take the real history into what fiction can I write in historical fiction, I can only imagine the psychology, why they must have done what they did. And the conversations, their body language, and the descriptions of the places, and the war. War, of course, is given in history books, but in very short manner. But you have to expand on that. So that is all you can do in historical fiction, you see.
This is so I actually second your thought, because for the longest period of time, like whenever I have read historical fiction, especially when we talk about the Maratha Empire, so people either don't show the whole psychology behind what was happening at that time, or they over-dramatize it because for some reason, I don't know why, like for some reason, Maratha history has always been over-dramatized and people have been shown in like, you know, hero and villain sort of way.
See, ab koi bhi jab janam leta hai, wo hero ya villain nahi hota hai, right? When the baby is innocent. Circumstances jo uske saath hota hai duniya mein, how he or she is brought up, what kind of things the person faces and how the person reacts, it makes the person. It's genetic and environment, you see. So I cannot say he is a bad man and she is a bad woman, or he is extremely good or she is extremely naive or extremely good. Aisa nahi hota hai. When you look around, you will see shades of grey. आपने आप में भी देखेंगे और मुझ में भी है. We are all not good 100% at 100% of the time.
Absolutely.
And these people are also not exceptions. You see.
Correct.
These people are not exceptions.
Yeah.
So yeah, you have to show. If you read my Frontiers, there will be shades of grey in Emperor Badshah Aurangzeb's character also, you see?
Way. Correct. So, ma'am, I mentioned 2 points why I love this book. There's the third point as well. You have shown Badshah Aurangzeb in a very real manner. It's not someone who is extremely evil. It's not someone who is, jaisa wo batate hai, like all, in all other books or in fact, even films or TV shows, Badshah Aurangzeb is someone who is that fanatic guy jo religion ke peeche sab kuch kar raha hai, but aapne unka like bahut ek real image bataya ki what he was exactly, and he was a cunning ruler. That's the reality.
Actually, you know, his fanaticism, his religious attachment, what he realized during the war of succession, that if he was extremely good, better than all his brothers on the battlefield, because he was always thrown out by his father on various frontiers. So when he realized that Dara Shikoh is liberal, and the orthodox war heroes or generals will support him if he shows his religious nature. So actually he was so cunning, he used the religion as a tool to forge ahead. So he was very intelligent. Why I wanted to show him, so why I showed him, is he was really intelligent. And why I stressed on that point is, if you do not know how powerful and cunning and intelligent Badshah Aurangzeb was, then you will not know the importance of Chhatrapati Shivaji.
Yeah,
will you?
Yeah, absolutely.
See, Chhatrapati Shivaji was not fighting with a Galika Gunda.
Right.
Was he fighting with a Galika Gunda? No.
Yeah.
He was fighting with a huge enemy. And that is how you can show if there was a Marathi analyst, Narhar Kurundkar. Now he died 60 years ago. Imagine. What he said, if you do not understand Badshah Aurangzeb, you do not understand Chhatrapati Shivaji. That's it.
Wow.
So those words etched in my mind, you see.
Right.
That is how.
And ma'am, bahut sahi line hai. Like for example, if you do not understand who Ravan was, you cannot understand who Shri Ram was, right? So it's the same thing. Agar aap Badshah Aurangzeb ko nahi samjhoge, Chhatrapati Shivaji ya pure Maratha Empire ko aap nahi samajh sakte. And that's very accurate. Ma'am, that being said, let's talk about the Maratha Empire. Now, it's a huge, huge, huge history of Maratha Empire. Unfortunately, in the national history of India, it's not recognized as much as the maybe Rajput history is recognized, or in fact, the freedom fight is recognized. How would you describe the Maratha Empire, first of all?
Chhatrapati Shivaji was born as a Jagirdar. To understand Maratha history and the intelligence or vision of Chhatrapati Shivaji, you must know this. There was a Mughal Empire. Okay. Yeah. Then there was Adil Shahi Empire, contemporary, Nizam Shahi, Kutub Shahi. And then there was Vijayanagar Empire. And Vijayanagar Empire belonged to Hindu kings.
Right.
So what was their war strategy? Do you know what was their war strategy?
No, I'm not familiar.
You know, I will tell you. It's very interesting. To understand Maratha Empire, you must understand this, you know, before I go ahead.
Yeah.
Now, what these kings and emperors used to do, like you are, suppose, an emperor and I'm a warrior. So what you will tell me? Aap kya mujhe bolenge? Medha ji, main aapko 1000 villages de raha hu. Okay? Aap wo villages ke king jaise hai. Okay?
Correct.
आप क्या करना वहां से, what was the industry that time? Agriculture industry, the main industry. So you collect the there are vatandars, the hereditary tax collectors. You collect the taxes of farming from them and keep a cavalry force for me. Okay, so when I need you, Medhaji, you come with 1,000 horses, 2,000, depending on how much land I give you. 2,000 horses, 3,000 horses, and help me, horsemen.
Right.
So, you know, in your language, young people's language, it is like outsourcing military.
Right, absolutely. Yes.
Huh? So, you will not believe, if Mughal Empire had 22 or 23 provinces, 80% of this land was under the Mansabdars. Jagirdars.
Correct.
So, so those days, whether you take Adil Shahi, Nizam Shahi, or Mughal Empire, these were titular emperors or titular kings or shahads.
Correct.
The real power was in the hands of Jagirdars, or in Mughal Empire, Mansabdars, who had the land. And that means you understand this, that the 80% of the Mughal Empire was ruled by military men. That means 80% of the Mughal Empire was under military rule. I do not know about Roman Empire and others, but in India, Why we call Chhatrapati Shivaji a visionary is that he is the first person. He was a Jagirdar's son. He was not born as a royal, or he was not born with a lot of money. He had about 100,000 villages under him, and he used to get about very little money from those villages.
Hmm.
His mother and he used to look after those villages.
So he
realized that this Jagirdari system, Jagirdars can get very powerful.
Correct.
And they can challenge the king. So like today's politicians, you know, they jump from one party to another. They sit on fence and disappear into five-star hotel to negotiate the deal. Like that, those days, Mansabdars or Jagirdars used to try coup and oust the king or the emperor. So Chhatrapati Shivaji was the only person who saw the flaw in this system. I just cannot understand how he saw it and how he realized it. It is as mysterious to me like Einstein creating E is equal to MC square. Yeah, tumhare language mein. Really.
Sorry.
So he realized that I am a Jagirdar son. I have taken over the... Who had given them the land? First Nizam Shahi. And then when they... Adil Shahi. They were under Adil Shahi.
Hmm.
He said, I can take over Adil Shahi's hill forts and I can challenge them. Tomorrow, some other Jagirdar's son can challenge me. So he wanted to demolish the entire Jagirdari system and bring military into under him, directly under him. And now, you know how we have... What is... So in the other empires and the kingdoms and Shahis, there was a king... or emperor, then there were Mansabdars or Jagirdars, and they used to have cavalry. So there was no, there was, and one Mansabdar would hate the other Mansabdar, where one Jagirdar will hate the other Jagirdar. So in military, how it is, if you give the order, like for example, we have general, then we have lieutenant general, then we have major general under that, then we have brigadier, like that. So if the general gives the order, it reaches, there's a chain of command, it reaches at the end. Chhatrapati Shivaji created that system. There was a Sarnaubat, Panchahazari, Hazari, you know, then Jumledar and Hawaldar, and then the trooper. So this system did not exist before him. So you must understand, all you youngsters, why we call Chhatrapati Shivaji a visionary. You know, this is his vision. And I also do not know from where he got the idea. Or how he thought about it. Because it was not a... I don't think he must have read Roman history or anything which was existing, perhaps. I don't think so.
When we talk about Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, it is very important to mention his childhood as well, because his childhood was where this whole idea of Swarajya was born, and the major reason it was born because of his mother Jijau Mata, right? Because she was telling him stories of Ramayana, she was telling him stories of the Rajput kings who had been before him. So I think so that's where he got to know about the flaws of these kings, and he built a whole vision on that, I guess.
No, I don't think so. So I do not belittle Jijamata's role in Chhatrapati Shivaji's childhood. She was a very strong woman. But the real taste of freedom, I'll tell you, he got because his father was away. 600 miles away in Karnataka. So his father was not a constant presence in his life. And those days, the kingdoms, the Shahis, used to keep a subedar of the area. You know, there was a subedar of the area. Under him, the Jagirdars will come to keep a watch on whether Jagirdars are collecting money, keeping same promised horses. And Jagirdars will keep an eye on hereditary tax collectors, Watandar. So that area was so hilly where Chhatrapati Shivaji was living. And it was not like very rich area where... So there was no Subedar for many years in that area. So Chhatrapati Shivaji, as a Shivaji Raja at that time, he got a taste of freedom. Nobody is there to tell him anything. So wow. that taste of freedom when he got, he didn't want to let it go. You see, that freedom. That is why in Frontiers, in one of the, and even in Sambhaji, he tells his wife that why I love freedom is that it allows me to do what I want, and it allows me not to do the wrong things. You see, that is how.
Yeah. I remember reading this.
Yeah. So taste. He tells Putalama, his Putala, his wife, Putala Rani.
Correct.
You see. Yeah. Right. So.
And this is exactly what I was talking about when we started this podcast. You are the only historian, especially in the when it comes to Maratha history, when you look at things from a very, you know, different perspective altogether. Like for a normal reader like me, who is not a historian, obviously, but has been reading a lot on Maratha history. So the perspective which I had built was that Chhatrapati Shivaji, all his life, he was who he was because of his mother. But then you have added a new lens to that whole conversation now.
No, his mother was a very strong presence in his life.
Yeah, no doubt.
But no doubt, you know, she was a very steely and very... But I'll tell you what. In Frontiers, I have seen her... I have shown her that she was little scared when he goes to the Mughal territory to fight. And she's worried about him. So I have written that she was little scared because he had gone to Aurangzeb's territory, because he'll come back alive or not. She didn't know. So many historians said, how can you write like that? Because she was a Veera Mata. Wo to ek Veera Mata thi. So maine unko bola, aap pehle mata bano, phir aapko lagega bacche ke baare mein kitna, you know, you are actually... I'm a mother of two boys. So I know. So I could look at this from another perspective, you see. Ki main kitni bhi veer mata hu, to mera bachcha jab Kargil mein hai, to mujhe dar to lagega na. Lagega na.
Absolutely.
Aapke maa ko bhi lagega. If she doesn't get you on phone for some time, she'll be worried. How much ever veer mata she is, you see.
Yeah.
That way. So, being a woman, it gave me a different perspective, absolutely, even to look at Sambhaji. Yeah.
So, ma'am, you know, wo bahut accurate point hai, because it just hit me. Like few years back, I was on a project in Egypt, and when I went there from India, for the first day, my SIM card wasn't working because it needed some activation or something. And my mother was stressed over here. She called me the next day and she shouted at me. So I can totally understand that point. Yeah, makes sense. Makes
I'm
sense.
I'm forever stressed. I'm forever stressed. Yeah.
That absolutely makes sense. Yeah. And
yeah. So you have to think as a human being. See, they were figures in our history, but they were also humans, you see.
Right.
They were also humans. That way.
So ma'am, like, I want to know from you, you have mentioned one name in the book, which is of Henry Oxenden, and like, I did a Google search on him, and I don't think so. It's a fictitious character. It's a real person, like, who was present at that time, because his diary was found. Ma'am, can you explain, like, what was written in his diary regarding the Maratha Empire, especially the coronation of Shivaji Maharaj?
I'll tell you what was written. See, when you study history, when you study history, the best research, the best true facts you can find in correspondence.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, correspondence. That time's correspondence. Why I said Sambhaji was extremely good looking? Because when he went to Agra, there are letters from Rajputs to Rajputs.
Yeah.
Na badiya looking hai, you know. To aap to uska uske sa uske dekhte hi rehte hai. It's in the correspondence. That's why I based him and made him a very handsome person. Okay.
Yeah.
Similarly, Henry, there are English records. Letters are there.
Yeah.
And in that, but the language, that English is very difficult to understand. It's kind of a 17th century English.
It's not the modern English. Yeah.
So in his diary, he has written, he did not understand much from the what was going on, you see. And he thought that it was too ritualistic. That is why I put Shenvi in the middle. to explain to him, you see. But Shenvi went with him. Shenvi is not a fictitious character. Shenvi is a translator. Yeah, he's not a fictitious character at all.
Okay, I thought you made that character because you needed to bridge that gap, but
No. He is there. He was there and he was a translator because he had to discuss politics and other things with the new Peshwa. How he would discuss that? He needed a translator. But I have added little extra point that Shenvi was little chatterbox and he explained everything. So that is my imagination, you see. But the characters are not fictitious. A diary was written by Henry Oxenden. Yeah. What I forgot to mention, actually, he brought a lot of gifts. But that would have, you know, I wanted to show more of war. And it's taken for granted that when you go for a ceremony, he must... There is a list of things he took in the history books, you know.
Yeah.
So that I didn't show that much. You know? That I didn't want to bore people with that.
Got it.
Yeah.
Awesome. So because, you know, why I asked this, because when we talk about Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, the maximum number of people know about him through a very Indian perspective. And it is important to know what the Britishers and the Portuguese at that time were thinking about the whole Maratha Empire. And for a matter of fact, like, you know, there were so many empires at that time, like Portuguese, British, Mughals, Nizam Shahi. Then there were the Rajputs in the north, then Afghans. And then here's a Maratha Empire that is being born. And soon it will be capturing all of India. So it is very important to understand this whole perspective. So that's why I loved it. Like the way you have set that whole character and the way he talks and he writes his diary. It's really interesting.
Yeah, that's true. And that is why I have taken the Mughal, the Rajputs, the English, the Portuguese, the Dutch, and also the Bijapurians, that is Adil Shahi people, Qutub Shahi people, all their perspectives, what they thought, how they changed the colors, all that, I had to show that, you see.
Exactly. So it's a you know, big khichdi of politics that's going on in that era because of all these empires. And everyone is trying to eat. Yeah.
Khichdi to paka nahi thi, you know. Right. But little bit, thoda sa tadka bhi chahiye tha usko.
Right. Absolutely. So, ma'am, like, let's come to the main topic of this podcast. And before we talk about the main character, the main person on whom this book is based, that is Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj. I feel Sambhaji Raje has been shown in a very negative light, especially in the recent past, because I remember reading this one book. I don't want to take the name of the book, but it's a very popular book which came out recently. And the writer is a very popularly known Marathi journalist. And he has mentioned that Sambhaji
Maharaj...
I know
the book.
He mentioned that Sambhaji Maharaj killed his own ministers. He went on to rape women and he was on substance abuse. So I want to know from you, what is the reality?
Yeah. So I thought like you before, you know. But then I started reading seriously about Sambhaji Raje.
Yeah.
First, you have to think how research should be based on. Youngsters like you, I would even, because I come from as a microbiologist, I was writing medical articles in Gulf News. I mean, sorry, Khalij Times in the Gulf. I wrote about 300 to 400 articles, you know, in the span of 10 years. And not a single time anybody complained. Because writing a medical article is a very serious thing. You cannot write wrong. And I was writing on a serious allopathy medicine. And now I was not writing about Ayurveda. I was writing about allopathy and I had to put up research, show research. That gave me a discipline that unless you are sure, you don't write. You see, that is how the background. Then I started reading. As I told you, a correspondence is the best way to understand what was really happening in that era. And then comes after correspondence comes the travelogue. Travelogue. People traveling and writing.
Traveling, right.
Why would they write false things? Okay. Then comes history written on copper plates. Correct. And then comes bakhar. Okay. So first bakhar on
before you move on, can you explain what is bakhar?
Bakhar is the contemporary people that time, they write in that language, you know.
Okay,
and there are no reference. Bakhar is always, it's very interesting question you ask. Bakhar is always commissioned. Okay, if I'm working, you are the emperor and I'm working for you. You say, Medhaji, I pay you this much, you write the bakhar. So what will be my first reaction? What will be? I will write good about you.
Yeah.
I'm getting money. I'm getting paid. And bakhar is not, it does not have references at the end. No bibliography. So what the bakhar maker thinks, he writes. So first bakhar on Maratha Empire, Maratha Shahi, what you call, was written by, now I don't remember the name, first name, in 1697, first bakhar was written on him. Sabhasad, his name is Sabhasad.
Okay.
So he didn't write anything bad about Sambhaji Raje. He wrote the bakhar, but it was praising Raja Ram because Raja Ram, the younger brother of Sambhaji Raje, had commissioned it.
Okay.
See?
Got it.
And then after 100 years, one Mallar Chitnis, whose great-great-grandfather Balaji Auji were executed by Sambhaji because he wanted to oust Sambhaji Raja. Now suppose somebody wants to kill you, you are going to kill me. Suppose I come running with a knife.
Exactly. And that too twice, right?
Twice. Yeah. He gave.
Yeah.
So his great-great-great-grandson was this Mallar Chitnis.
Okay.
So after 100 years, without any references, he writes about a woman.
Got it.
I don't know where that Godavari name comes from. He says, someday, some women came to Raigad.
Wow.
So this is incorrect. As a medical person whom I'm writing medical issues, I cannot write, someday, if I got some injection, maybe this will happen. That's not reference, you see.
Right.
So it is so funny, you know. And some days, some women came to Raigad. And if you read this book, he was hardly in Raigad.
Correct.
Their capital. After, when Chhatrapati Shivaji goes for southern campaign, Shambhu Raja goes to his wife's place in Sringarpur to look after the Subha of Ratnagiri. Right? So he was never there. So this itself and the entire many fiction writers took this as as a main reference and wrote fictitious stories on real history, and that became a real history.
Correct.
There was a movie called Manjula or Kamla, I don't know what. There they say Sambhaji Raje molested her at Panhala. Okay, Panhala. And there is a tomb or a samadhi of that. Udhar ek samadhi hai, bolte hai. Udhar ek samadhi hai. So, jab unhone research kiya wo samadhi ke material ka, wo jo material available tha, wo Sambhaji Raje marne ke baad 100 years later. So, it was the tomb of somebody from Peshwa time, you see.
Oh, wow.
So, it was all rubbish they wrote.
Correct.
And being a woman, I knew if I want to, and especially boys, if I want to make them angry, it's so easy for a grown-up woman, you know. They have this passive aggression. I have seen my aunts and my other relatives, women relatives, behaving that way. And you know how, and I myself must have done many times passive aggression to show, because I cannot show real aggression.
Right.
And hassle the men in the house. You know, sometimes poor men, actually, they become victims. So, I know how women act. How I know how there is a home politics. And you must have also seen it, you know, all of us. Because ye ghar ghar ki kahani hai. So, udhar bhi ghar ghar ki kahani thi wo. So, he was subjected to, and he was very handsome. So you imagine a handsome prince of a very illustrious king Many women must have got attracted to him, you see. Now you see our heroes, so many women. That might have happened, I don't know. But I do not want to waste my pages of my precious book on this references which are not based on true stories. True history. Then after that, after this chitneys, Sir Grant Duff wrote, James Grant Duff wrote Maratha history, and he also cursed Sambhaji Raje based on chitneys' reference.
Oh, wow.
After that came G.S. Sardesai.
Yeah.
He was such a renowned historian. They used to call him Riyasatkar. Mujhe abhi Hindi mein mat poochho Riyasatkar ka kya meaning hai. But
it was his
padvi hai wo. Padvi or title.
Right.
So that Riyasatkar also, he carried forward James Grant Duff's story. And after that, Riyasatkar Shejwalkar, who उन्होंने तो मराठा हिस्ट्री पुणा के एक कॉलेज में सिखाया वो भी वही लिखते हैं एंड देन द मूवीज आर कमिंग आउट इट इज अ एब्सोल्यूट कैरेक्टर असासिनेशन ऑफ शंभू राजे देन थ्री ऑथर्स केम एंड रोट दे रियली स्टडीड द कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंस ट्रेवलॉग्स एंड हिस्ट्री रिटन ऑन कॉपर प्लेट्स एंड They also studied the Muslim historians of the era. Muslim historians also had to say, and they were also great historians.
Right.
And they also wrote the truth. So they found Sambhaji Raje behaved like this. There is no correspondence. There is absolutely no correspondence. There is no proof. So Dr. Kamla Fadke, who did her PhD, for 9 years, that lady did a PhD. Her daughter gave me her book because it was out of print.
Yeah.
Then when Mr.
Ma'am, what is the book's name?
Shivaputra Sambhaji.
Okay, got it.
But it is like, it is not a story. It is absolute PhD thesis.
PhD thesis, academic book.
PhD thesis, academic book.
Okay.
And her daughter Manjiri Marathe gave me this book, which was out of print.
Okay.
Then I got Bendre. He wrote another book, fat book. And another is Shivde, Dr. Shivde. These books were given to me by Dr. Varsha Mule. She is the head of the Department of History in Sion College in Mumbai.
Okay.
They were all out of print. So I studied those books. Then I found one book, one person had collected all this. Muslim historians, Hindu historians, he collected the entire thing and created Sambhaji Smarak Granth. Fat book. That I got it in Ahmadnagar Museum. So I read that and his analysis is so perfect, which is given in this Marathi book, 100 page.
Okay.
See this Jai Singh Rao Pawar. He is Mr. Gajanan Mehendale is my guru in, is my hero in Chhatrapati Shivaji's writing. Mr. Jai Singh Rao Pawar is my guru or my hero in Sambhaji's writing, Sambhaji Raja's writing.
Yeah.
So this man, he's written Chhatrapati Sambhaji Ek Chikitsa, means an analysis. So he wrote logically why this would not have happened and why this would have happened. So Jai Singh Rao Pawar's writing is the basis of my Sambhaji novel.
Correct.
So this is how I had to... this is how I had to do research. And again, then again, when you are an author of a book, you have to also use your brain, you know. After reading all this, you have to also think what might have happened, what might have been said, how women or men must have reacted at that time. So you have your brain also. You cannot leave it behind, you see. After reading all this, you have to think logically and you have to imagine things in your own way and then write the book.
Right.
It comes like that.
Wow. So I can imagine like the amount of research that has gone into the whole book. And it's tremendous research because you cannot describe the whole psychology behind every decision if you do not know what was the outcome, not from one point, but from multiple points.
Correct. And you know how long I'm reading Maratha history?
From
1999 to understand,
get
it into my system. And I had a day job. I had two children to feed and look after their studies. And then, so they were not very young, but still I had to look after them. And my day job was very demanding. I worked for Modern Pharmaceuticals in Dubai. If you read Challenging Destiny, which is a biography of Chhatrapati Shivaji, even Napoleon Bonaparte has said that it is impossible to create an army from scratch.
Exactly. Yeah.
You should have something at least to build upon, which Chhatrapati Shivaji never had.
Yeah,
also, another thing I feel as a woman, not in history, as a woman I feel, Chhatrapati Shivaji never had a father figure in his life. So perhaps he was also confused, you know, to how to be a father. Though he kept the best teachers, the best sword fighters, the best Sanskrit Gurujis for Sambhaji, but how you... I see there are many people cannot show their love, you see. Like in Hindi movies, we don't hug our mother and father all the time.
Right.
You see? And boys have a different way. Men have a different way to show their love.
Correct.
And women have
Correct.
A different way to show their love. But some people love somebody so much, but they cannot show it. And some people show so much love, but they don't really love you.
Right.
So it depends on person to person. So I feel as a woman... Chhatrapati Shivaji didn't, he was confused how to show love to his child. And his child needed the love because he did not have mother.
Correct.
He wanted his father to show him the love. Validation.
Yeah.
He was looking for validation. So there somewhere like in every ghar ghar ki kahani, you know.
And like, you know, always a father and a son have a sort of a love-hate relationship everywhere. It's very natural.
They have.
So,
natural.
I totally get
you
it. Because
you can't be just fully in love with your father all the time. And if you're not hated once, you're not a parent. That's a saying in English.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
And like you just mentioned ki Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj had, he kept a lot of teachers for Sambhaji Maharaj. This is one aspect of his life which a lot of people don't know, which is that he was well versed in a lot of languages and he used to write. And this is the first time in your book I got to know that he has written so many books. So can you tell us about the whole academic side of his life?
See, like for example, as I said in my book, he met Kavi Kalash, the poet in Mathura.
Yeah.
And I think Sambhaji Raje was a quick learner, I think, because it is impossible to master Braj Bhasha in that short span of time.
Yeah.
But not only he mastered, but he wrote two books on that. One is Nakshik, means a woman's beauty from Shik means head and Nak means still the nail, toenail.
Wow. You
know, the woman's beauty. Yeah. And then there was another manuscript he wrote, Naika Bhed. You know, how different women pine for love. It is a beautiful book. It's very...
Yeah.
But the most important what he wrote was Buddha Bhushan. What he wrote in that granth is, first he wrote about his father. I have translated that verse in English. Life and Death of Sambhaji, you see.
Correct.
And I have also translated a verse about Radha's beauty. What Krishna, from Krishna's eyes, what he writes.
Correct.
It's a very beautiful verse, you know.
Yeah.
So he wrote that Buddha Bhushan contains how you should handle the administration of a nation. He also took help of a lot of old manuscripts written by many scholars and took part of their verses in this book and he gave them credit.
Yeah.
But the most important thing, he wrote some verses about how an animal or a bird would behave and how we can learn from that animal and bird. So there are many birds and many animals which have come in this manuscript, that if a lion can behave this way, a human should behave that way, you see.
Correct.
So it was very intelligent kind of granth, you know.
Right.
So he showed us the examples of animals and birds and what we can take from there. That kind of Buddha Bhushan. Another thing, he also wrote something on Adhyatma. Now, I don't know how to ये कैसे ट्रांसलेट करना अध्यात्म ये वर्ड इन इंग्लिश में मुझे नहीं पता, फिलोसॉफी में भी उसमें भी उन्होंने बहुत सारा लिखा है. एंड उन्होंने ब्रज भाषा और संस्कृत दोनों में, बिकॉज संस्कृत इज अ डिफिकल्ट लैंग्वेज यू सी, बट ही हैड मास्टर्ड इट, सो ही मस्ट हैव बीन एन इंटेलिजेंट मैन. एंड वेयर वाज द टाइम, उधर किधर टाइम था टू रन आफ्टर विमेन, देयर वाज नो टाइम इन हिज लाइफ यू सी. जस्ट थिंक अबाउट लॉजिक, एंड ही हैड अ ब्यूटीफुल वाइफ एंड वेरी इंटेलिजेंट एंड वेरी स्पिरिटेड गर्ल एज हिज वाइफ यू सी.
करेक्ट करेक्ट. And also he had just one wife. When you are living in an era jahan pe Mughals to had a full harem,
but there are some eternal truth and there are some time bound truths, you know, like aaj ke zamane mein do wife rakhna ye anyay hai.
Correct.
It's against law.
Yeah,
but wo zamane mein having 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 wives for political reasons or otherwise, it's a normal thing. It was not against law. So you can't judge somebody's character because he had 4 wives or 5 wives. Of course, harem is a different thing.
Yeah.
What is the eternal truth? What is the eternal truth? Molesting a woman now and molesting a woman then is against law. That is, it is not morally correct. That is the eternal truth. Another thing I will tell you about Chhatrapati Shivaji. That time, I must tell you, I just realized it. I must tell you this. Then, in Mughal era, may it be the Mughal Empire, maybe it Adil Shahi, or maybe Kutub Shahi, Nizam Shahi. When you capture an enemy woman or children, they were treated as perks of war. You know perks?
Yeah.
You get in job? So, first time in our history, Chhatrapati Shivaji brought in the military rule and military punishment.
Wow.
First time he started punishing his own soldiers for misbehaving in enemy territory with women and children. Can you believe? Right. When it was a perk of war, it was a prize.
Ma'am, and you have mentioned this in the book as well, right? I don't remember exactly which phase this was, but his military was marching through a territory, and there are written records ki unki military ne itna achha behave kiya ki people never felt they are coming to wage war. So that shows a lot
of they paid also for their things.
Yeah.
So it was he was the first time who brought in. Now we punish soldiers for this and that, you know, but that time he started that. And he also told the Dutch people that nobody thought of human trafficking was against law that time.
Yeah.
But, and it was very profitable.
Yeah.
The Mughal liked it. The Portuguese became very rich with human trafficking.
Siddhis also
Siddhis.
Correct.
But first Raja, Chhatrapati Shivaji, why he is my muse and why I spent 20 years of my life studying him is that he was against transportation and selling of humans as gulam. And he told the Dutch, now the East Coast is with me and if you do that, I will stop your business.
Wow.
Imagine that time to think. Now we talk about human trafficking, you see.
Ma'am, I had few topics that I wanted to cover before I came to this point, but since we are talking about how Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj stopped the human trafficking, he took so many military actions and punished people, I want to know from you, like, in the book you have also mentioned the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj and Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj as well, they stopped Portuguese, they stopped Britishers from converting Hindus to Christianity, right? And that too without their will. And in one interview you have said it was not a war of religion. Then what was it exactly and why was this happening?
Yeah, So, you know, it was Chhatrapati Shivaji never said that I'm against Muslims. Never he said. It was not war of religion. What he wanted to, what he wanted his subjects or his rayat to live is, he wanted his subjects to have freedom the way they wanted to live. If they wanted to follow, if they wanted to go to the temple, they wanted to go to the mosque, they wanted to go to church, they should, they can. But you, when Portuguese were actually weakened by the time Chhatrapati Shivaji came into existence. In 16th century, Portuguese were very cruel, you see. And they had, by the time Chhatrapati Shivaji came to power, most of the people in that area were all converted. And and they actually, they forgot their culture, the way they dressed, the way they ate, the way they prayed, everything, they were like brainwashed. And the, and you can see, it's read my Challenging Destiny, how they were punished in 16th century. So, yes, Chhatrapati Shivaji and Shambhu Raje tried to acquire the Portuguese territory for political reasons. You know, they wanted the entire, because they wanted to start the merchant navy. And merchant, you know, why did Chhatrapati Shivaji start naval bases? He wanted to capture naval bases. They build the ships, not to fight against Siddhis and Portuguese. Of course, they fought against Siddhis and Portuguese. But the real reason was Portuguese and Siddhis were taking away a lot of money by transporting goods from India to Middle East. So Chhatrapati Shivaji wanted the entire, there was only few ways to make legitimate money. Otherwise, looting and, you know, conquering the enemy territory. Either agriculture or taxes to the merchants. So Chhatrapati Shivaji wanted to start a merchant navy. And he wanted that Konkan area and the east coast also. So that way, and to protect his merchant ships, he wanted to have the smaller ships, warships. So that was his vision, which was not that fulfilled, you know, because he died too soon.
I actually wanted to know, like, you know, since we are talking about the Portuguese as well, and we are talking about the kind of wars they were fighting. So Sambhaji comes in, he plunders Burhanpur, which is a very interesting moment in the whole episode, because he's over there. There's something happening in the whole family. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj was angry with him for defecting to the Mughals. So, so much has happened. Now he goes to plunder Burhanpur, and he plunders it with such skill. And you have written that whole chapter so beautifully. Like, I was reading it, and I could imagine that, okay, this is happening, this is happening, this is happening. So what kind of a person was Sambhaji when it came to wars?
Actually, he was very, very brave, you know. He may not have his father's vision. Again, I'm telling you, man like Chhatrapati Shivaji is born in one in millennium, in thousand years. So you cannot compare him with, it's not fair on Sambhaji Raje. But he was very brave on the battlefield, and he never cared for his life. And he had ideas about, and he was very angry with Diler Khan that time when he went to Burhanpur, you know. Because he had seen the atrocities the Mughal had committed in his own territory as well as in Adil Shahi. It was against his what teachings, what he had learnt. You see? You have read the book, you know, how he has seen. And he was, what I wanted to show, this is my imagination. Now, this is not in history book. But I realized that when he goes to Burhanpur, the memories of Diler Khan's plunder in Adil Shahi, as well as cutting of 700 people's hands, 700 soldiers, they were maimed in his own territory by Diler Khan. That was fresh in his mind. So that is why he takes the action what he takes in Burhanpur. Burns entire, all the produce or whatever goods and whatever he can take, he takes. But he plays a trick. He also, there is a trick he plays to fool the Burhanpur Subedar or whoever is there. You see, that I don't want to tell. Otherwise, people will not read my book.
But then, ma'am, if I had to ask you, and this is not like, you know, only about Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj, this is about the period when even Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj was ruling. If you had to, you know, just give sort of a story, like thing about a war that you thought was really interesting because the Marathas fought it with a lot of cunningness, then which war would that be? Because for a fact, I know Marathas fought with a lot of intelligence. They were really interesting characters when it came to wars. Like, agar kisi ne movie dekhi hai 300, which shows the whole aspect Marathas was that. So can you talk about few wars?
So from Sambhaji book, from this book, I will tell you, or
like whichever you think is the
one is you for. Must have seen how they defended Ramshej fort.
Very interesting. Correct.
So 3 years Mughal could not, you know, even think of climbing even one step of that hill fort, and that hill fort was not very high.
Right.
So, and how they made cannon out of tree trunks.
Correct.
Yeah, I have explained that. Another battle I like is how Sambhaji Raje waited for the Portuguese governor.
Yeah. Yeah.
And how they fight, you know, and how the Portuguese governor, they have to jump in the river to save themselves from the Marathas.
Correct.
That battle and also, I feel very...
And how cunningly
Sambhaji Raje retreated from Goa.
Exactly. Because, I was coming to that point.
So that was... And how he was not bothered about his life, that he let his horse go into Mandovi River.
Yeah.
When he was it, but that he was saved by Balaji Auji's son, Khandobalal, that time. Yeah.
Correct.
So that was a very interesting, I feel.
In fact, you have also mentioned this, right? That Portuguese were so, they were so feared. There's this one point where I don't remember what they do. Like, wo kisi ki to kabar nikalte hai, right?
Yeah,
I don't remember exactly. Can you describe that for the audience?
Kabar means they go to that their saint, somebody, you know, his...
I forgot the name. Yeah.
Yeah, I also forget the name. His body is kept there, and it's in the church. So Tavora, governor. He's so scared of the Marathas under Sambhaji Raje that he goes to that coffin. And he opens it and says, please save us from the Marathas. And that has happened in history. It is in history book. It's not
documented.
It's documented. Yeah, it's documented.
Correct. Because so I read that
these
somewhere.
Wars are all documented, whatever. But descriptions are mine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Wars are documented. Descriptions are mine.
So that's the most interesting part about the whole Maratha history, is the way they fight the wars, because they are so intelligent and they know if they go to the plains, there's a chance that they might get defeated. But if they are in their hill forts, no one can defeat them. And Ramsej Fort was a great example of that. And what shocked me was Aurangzeb himself has come all the way from north to Deccan, and for 3 years, they cannot even, you know, penetrate
one
Ramsej.
Fort, not even one fort.
Exactly.
That is why he goes to Adil Shahi and Qutub Shahi and wins them. You know how cruelly Bijapur is taken.
Right.
But what happens, you know, when I read other books on history, what I feel, many pages are filled with personal politics and talk.
Yeah.
But nobody shows the wars, you know, which I wanted to show.
And that's
I
most fascinating
to show
part.
How exactly, yes. And without that, the story is incomplete, you know. You have
Absolutely,
to show
yes.
the wars in your
Yes,
book.
Correct. Yeah. You have mentioned this in an interview as well. And as you said, there was this one analyst who has mentioned, agar aap Badshah Aurangzeb ko nahi samajhte, to aap Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj ko nahi samajhte. So, just a brief description of who Badshah Aurangzeb was, because we were having this call and I told you ki I felt he was a really intelligent man, because to... उसका जो बेटा था अकबर टू bring him down, he just sends one letter to the Rajputs, जिसके साथ में मिलके वो coup d'etat करने वाला था. It's a huge task, like that was so intelligent of him.
Yeah, so Aurangzeb was among his brothers, you know, he Darashikho, Shah Shuja.
And Darashikho was a great man.
Darashikho was a great man, but he was like, he never went to battlefields like
Aurangzeb. Yeah, he was liberal.
He was like mollycoddled.
Correct.
He was very intelligent. And according to Aurangzeb, he used to, Badshah Aurangzeb, he used to discuss defunct philosophies of Aristotle and Pluto with Hindu pundits.
Yeah.
So that was, yeah, he was intelligent. He, one of his poems, I'll tell you, Darashikho, if you have time.
Yeah, yeah, sure, ma'am.
He says, and all were poets, including Aurangzeb. Huh?
Yeah.
All were poets that time. How even Sambhaji Raja. Everybody was a poet.
Correct.
So Darashikho's one poem that says that why should I am a drop of rain. I should fall in the ocean. Why should I become a pearl? Why? Why not I become an ocean itself?
Oh,
it's a
wow.
beautiful poem. And Aurangzeb's poem, I'll tell you one beautiful poem. Life is a twinkle, a breath. Now it is life, now it was death.
Oh, it's like it's so deep. And I cannot imagine Aurangzeb writing this.
Yeah, it is his poem. It's his poem. Life is a twinkle, a breath. Now it was life, now it is death. Simple. I translated it, little tweaked. In English. Of course, this poem is there in Sir Yadunath Sarkar's books, but I didn't like his translation, so I did it in my own way.
Wow. And when you talk about Badshah Aurangzeb, to describe him as a poet, no one can even imagine that, because he's shown as a real cruel human being.
No. He every letter to his son, including in this book, there is a poem.
Yeah,
it
exactly.
Was his habit. His correspondence were full of very beautiful prose and poem. He should have been an author, actually.
This thought just hit me, and I don't know, like, I might get backlash from people for even asking this to you, which is, when we are talking about Aurangzeb, Badshah Aurangzeb and Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, do you see their, like, you know, similarities between them? I'm not talking about, like, their cruelties or how good they were. Not that. Just the way...
This is a very important question. Very important question. Both were great in the battlefield. Both knew how to fight wars. They were they were not only the statesmen, but they were the war generals also.
Exactly, you know?
So they were great. They were very, good with women. Aurangzeb never ever touched other women other than his wives. And so is Chhatrapati Shivaji.
Yeah.
They were clean characters. Okay.
Yeah.
The difference, only one I will tell you what the difference was. When in the enemy territory, even though Badshah Aurangzeb was so clean with women, he did not mind his soldiers capturing enemy women and children.
Yeah.
And selling them as slaves or whatever. That rule he never brought in. Chhatrapati Shivaji, very clean character, and he wanted all the people under him to be in clean. The military, a crime. The first time people heard of the word military war crime.
Yeah.
Not only he was clean and very chaste, but he wanted all his soldiers to be like him.
Correct.
So that was the main difference, you know. And he, of course, Aurangzeb used his religion to gain, to, you know, it was his means. Religion was his means to achieve his goal. Chhatrapati Shivaji never used his religion to achieve his goals.
Right.
It's a big difference. Correct. And nobody will say anything to you, because this is the truth. You see?
And ma'am, can you like, you know, say which was right, which was wrong? Because in the book as well, you have mentioned this, like, I think so. This is a conversation between Sambhaji Raje and someone from the Mughal camp. they are talking about Sambhaji Raja is telling him that why do you fight with each other, and the person is telling him ki hame pata hi nahi aur kaise rehna, this is the way of our life, like war of succession is something that has been happening since so many years, so we cannot live without it. So in a way these were two different
it's not like that. He asks why when he sees them molesting the women
and
sodomizing the children, which is happening, Athani, that is absolutely based on history. What I have written about the way they tortured in Athani and Tikota. It has happened. So he asked them that why he gets fed up, you know, he's frustrated now. He asked, why do you do this? So then Diler Khan says, these are the perks of war. So he says, no, these are crimes. So he says, in your father's rule, it is crime. But in our rule, unless, and we only listen to only one thing, Badshah's Farman, we are not, who are you for us to tell?
Correct.
Why are you telling me? Who are you? So this is what is, you know, is shocking.
So these were
two different ways. And Sambhaji Raja could not handle this way of life.
Yeah.
He had only seen the beauty of Mughal Empire at Agra. He had not seen the hell, what was happening in the battlefields. You see? It was all new to him. And after all, he was his father's son.
And ma'am, this was everything about the life of Sambhaji Maharaj, Chhatrapati Sambhaji Maharaj. Let's talk a little bit about his last days, his death. I was really shocked when I read the whole, you know, that incident. Like, and I don't want you to describe that because firstly...
No, I don't want to give away the end.
Yeah, because I want people to read this book. And secondly, it might trigger a lot of people because the cruelty of, you know, torturing him was really bad, really bad. So, can you talk about his death? And also, I really want to mention this, that whatever the people might think about Sambhaji Maharaj and his life, but in his death, he sort of, you know, sowed the seeds for the future of Maratha Empire, for the future of whole Hindustan. So please, ma'am, can you describe about his ending days?
Ending days means it is all rubbish when people write that Badshah Aurangzeb asked him to convert to Islam and he said, if you give me your daughter, I will convert.
Yeah,
Nothing like that.
This is the most popular incident.
No. There is a paymaster general, Ruhullah Khan. He comes there, which I have written is completely based on history and on the analysis of Jai Singh Rao Pawar.
Yeah.
Ruhullah Khan comes and he says, 250, most of the forts are bought by the Mughal.
Yeah.
Because Aurangzeb had a lot of money from Qutub Shahi conquer. Na?
Correct.
So Ruhullah Khan says that why don't you give us the keys? Ask those 250 kiledars, unko surrender karne ko bolo, hame keys de do. They know each fort will take at least 1 year to take. So 250 years they have to be here.
Yeah.
So that is refused. That time Sambhaji Raja realizes that what I should do, which will now Badshah Aurangzeb has lit the fire of jihad in the hearts of his soldiers.
Yeah.
What decision shall I take so that an inferno of freedom, an inferno of anger against Badshah Aurangzeb is lit, of Swaraj is lit in all the Marathas.
Right.
And Maratha, I mean, the Kunbi Maratha, the farmers, the Brahman Marathas, the Balutedar Marathas, all Marathi-speaking people are Marathas.
Yeah.
Okay. So how will I light that inferno in the hearts of all the Marathas? How, actually, after, I'm also reading references now, how how the fire is lit and how the Marathas fight back. That sequel of Sambhaji, I'm just studying.
Correct.
But I don't know as
in yet. Fact, like you are planning to write a book as well on that, right? Like from Sambhaji Maharaj's death and Aurangzeb's death, right?
I want to, but you know, it's it will take time and
Yeah,
a lot of
absolutely.
research has to go
Because,
in. Yeah.
and ma'am, I really want you, as a fan, I'm saying this, I really want you to write this book because when you, in the book, you have mentioned that Sambhaji Maharaj talks with Tarabai's father for Raja Ram, like their marriage. And you have said that
Yeah.
they didn't know that Maratha region's next savior had come. So I really want to know that history now.
I know. And one of the authors who read Sambhaji, she called me and said, "You must write further. I'm
Yeah.
so angry with Badshah Aurangzeb. I want to read further, you know."
Yeah. And
So I want to.
also for those who don't know, like what happens after Sambhaji Maharaj's death, the whole history takes a really huge 90-degree turn when Tarabai
Yes.
comes in, and there's so much happening because I
Lots
Googled
of
it for
happening.
this episode. So I just have very basic knowledge, but then I know a lot of things happened.
That
So
is a
yeah.
very poignant thing because Sambhaji Raje's wife Yesu Rani and her children are in
Yeah.
Aurangzeb's camp. So I'm
Right.
sure people want to know what happens there.
Yeah.
You see?
And like Shahu Maharaj, which is Sambhaji Maharaj's son, he comes back and then a lot of things happens.
Yeah,
So
but I'm not going that further, you know. That is
yeah.
later on.
Correct,
So that's
correct,
an
correct.
interesting history, in very interesting. But Maratha
Yeah.
history has been neglected. And
Absolutely.
yeah, and I'm so glad that somebody chose me to write this, you see.
Yeah.
Somebody, a higher power, I don't know.
Ma'am, I did a episode with Vikramjeet Roop Rai. So he's a historian and an educator. And he told me a very interesting thing about history and how history needs to be taught. He just said simply one line, history tabhi samajh aayegi jab history relevant hogi. And you have made Maratha history relevant at a national level with this book and with your previous books as well. So thank you so much for writing these books, ma'am.
No, I'm glad, you know, youngsters like you are reading it. That is my prize.
Yes,
Yeah,
absolutely. So,
that is my
ma'am,
prize.
like one last question, that is like we ask this question to everyone who comes on the show, which is your book recommendations, which you think that everyone should read at least once in their life. So maybe like three books.
Oh, gosh,
And it
really?
can be any book, like English, Marathi, any literature.
Oh, see, in Marathi there is a book called Mrityunjay,
Oh wow, yeah,
isn't
beautiful
it?
book.
That nobody,
Yeah.
but those only who understand Marathi or read Marathi can
Yeah,
read it.
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and then yeah, that book is fantastic, you see.
Correct.
Then I got so many, you know, and I'm a Jeffrey Archer fan.
Oh wow.
You see,
Correct.
and yeah, then I liked Arundhati Roy's God of Small Things,
Beautiful
though
book, yeah.
I didn't read her next book, but that was
Yeah.
a beautiful book.
Yeah.
Then there are many books, you know, in Marathi itself I have read so many beautiful books. Like there
Correct.
is a Shashi Bhagwat, an author which nobody
Yeah.
knows now. He
Yeah.
has
Yeah.
written mythology books, you know,
Correct.
Marma Bhed and Raktarekha. Oof,
Oh,
nobody
yes.
has written. So I don't know,
So,
they're out of print. How I learned to write historical fiction, from who is
Yeah.
my guru? There is one person called, is a history professor in England called Con Iguldan. Con Ig Iguldan. He
Okay,
has
got it.
written 5 books on Genghis Khan.
Oh, wow.
Those books, he takes you to that era. And what
Wow.
was the, and he is my guru. Another guru is Hilary Mantel, who has written Henry the Eighth.
Yeah.
Okay. So what was the best compliment? One doctor from Hinduja Hospital, he read my Frontiers and he wrote to me, he reminded me of Con Iguldan, and at places you are even better than him. So I
Wow.
was like, 3 nights I couldn't sleep, you see.
Yeah.
So these
Wow.
are my heroes. Yeah, these are
Wow.
my people who actually showed me through their work. I never talked to them, through their
Correct.
work, how to write a historical novel.
Correct. Wow. So in fact now I will pick up
So
these
Con
books on Genghis
Iguldan, yeah,
Khan.
Con Iguldan, Google him, and
Correct.
Hilary Mantel, Bring Up the Bodies, one of her books' name.
So
So
I'll
yeah.
definitely I'll definitely buy these books because Genghis Khan is someone who is a really good read. Yeah,
if you read those books, you will not live in this world for 6 months.
Wow. I'm definitely going to buy those books just after this recording. So, Medha ma'am, thank you so much for coming on the show and talking about these things.
No, thank you for calling me.
Yeah.
Thank you for inviting me. Sorry for the lights off.
No
I
issues,
hope
ma'am,
you,
no issues.
You could see me.
Yeah. No issues. So, whoever is watching this right now on YouTube or listening on Spotify, please go ahead, buy this book, Life and Death of Sambhaji Maharaj. It's a beautiful read. Like, main to bol raha hu, like, mujhe 5 days tak wahi dreams aa rahe the. I was living in that life. So do pick up this book. It will take you to some other universe. It will really make your life a little bit entertaining and educate you a lot on the Maratha history. So thank you so much, Medha ma'am, for doing this.